ice. But, you know, with this, take the trucks and Xfinity to Irwindale. And so I think that's how they're going to.
All that, and we've been offline for about 30 seconds.
Love it. Cool.
No, it's my bad. Internet again.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's fine. Do we need to like move it? We're gonna stay on your channel, right, Jarrett? Or okay, so just like go live again, and it'll be like a two-parter, I guess.
Yeah, hold on one second. I'm making sure because it keeps saying on here. It has on the green on mine, like so. It almost says like we're.
It's back. It's back. Okay. It's back. All right. Let's go. This is basically part two. This is part two again.
All right. Yeah. It should be good.
All right.
Let me refresh. Might actually be the same one. And it just, yeah. It's saying it's on.
Yep. It's on. Just make sure the screen and all that stuff is adjusted on there.
Yeah. It's good.
All right.
So my apologies because you were really getting off on there and I was like really into it. And then all of a sudden I basically just sort of like my stream zonked out on me.
Yeah.
All good.
Yeah, no, it's all good. All right. Happens.
So we're good.
Okay, there we go. Now we popped up on the stream. All right. So, Hannah, go back into your point, what you were saying before we cut out.
No, all good. I'll just spark notes, kind of what we were just talking about. Basically, you commented on, you know, them creating the 2021 season ending in September, and we've been told it's to be able to entertain the aspect of having that championship race be rotated around because most of our tracks can't host a championship race in November because of weather. So that's why they're doing that. And then they're also entertaining the idea of cutting, like going to Texas twice. They've already cut, you know, New Hampshire twice. And also entertaining the idea of, you know, creating a schedule that allows us to go to Indy, but go to Indy and also IRP, mm-hmm. but go to Fontana and take the trucks to Irwindale with Xfinity. So create that still like Ooh. Integrating short tracks and road course, but allowing it to rotate. And our schedule is just so grueling, man. Like mm-hmm. we have such a long schedule and I can't tell you how many times we hit like August and half of us are ready to just die.
No, I could tell over the weekend, like everyone, like the crews, the drivers, team, media members, they were just done. Yeah, they were just done. Like, dude, I've seen you too many times. I'm sick of this. Right, I'm done.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I remember I was on pit road. Oh crap, Mike. Okay. Yeah, I saw you on pit road, and I was like, you and a few other people in the media, and it's like, you know, do stuff on camera, and then it's like, where's the next one at? Let's go.
Yeah. Like, let's go. It's like, God damn it. Like,
you're just a war thin at that point. And like, don't get me wrong, I work with great people. I love the people that I travel with. And like, I'm fortunate that I get to travel with like my boyfriend every single weekend. And that honestly has been a godsend, as weird as that is, because otherwise we wouldn't see each other. But yeah, I mean, even like one of my bosses, when we were loading up after the Xfinity race, he was like, thank goodness we are done after this weekend. Cause about five people in this group would kill each other by the next weekend if it wasn't over the season. Cause
it's like, hey, I love you, but I don't love you all the time.
Yeah, like space. We need to take a break.
Yeah, 2 month break. That's for sure.
When I think that, you know, you're with this being moved up. Like you said, the finale can go basically anywhere at this point. I think it would probably make going to ISM as a finale maybe a little more difficult the closer to the summer you get. Either way, but you know, it's like that'd be about the weekend. You know, we're close to where like Chicagoland was, and even though it was a little cold at that point, it's still. You go up north more, you probably would have, the way I would see it, you could probably have the Southern 500 even be the cutoff race if you wanted.
I would like that.
You can race Daytona, even though, you race Daytona if you wanted, or Talladega. You could race really anywhere on the schedule for the most part as the finale, which would be good. See, the only thing I'm thinking of is as long as they do what the NFL does with the Super Bowl and announce in advance where the finale will be, That way that, you know, tracks have that amount of time to prepare, you know, and depending on if they go down to one race for whatever season it might be that they do it. But I would totally be all for shortening up, compacting the schedule, because I think through 2024, the contract has them that they have to do 36, like, for the TV deal. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you can compact that together, and that way, once new one comes out, new TV or broadcasting rights go out, then you probably be able to at least cut some of them if it was, you know, too much at one period of time. You kind of avoid that NFL TV rating overlap, which, as much as NASCAR fans say that most NASCAR fans don't watch the NFL, like, I think that's a lie. There's a huge overlap with the most popular sport in America with every sport. Mm-hmm. And then they're also talking about moving the Daytona 500 maybe forward a week or so. I know there was being talked about, just because the Super Bowl might get moved a few weeks more because of the NFL going to 18 or 17 games coming up. So it's like, I would be all for it, just because I think if you can keep that momentum going, just race after race after race after race after race, then it gives people, and then have that, what would be like September, October, November, you know, December, January, 5 month break instead of three. And I think it would give a lot more fans, like, a lot more incentive to watch continuously through the season instead of skipping like the summer months or something. I'd be all for it, and I think it would actually really, really help long term.
I would also love for the sport to tap into some brand new markets. I mean, you already got the big ones on lock, but maybe go out, you know, west or down south a little bit more. Hannah, you're from Idaho, correct?
Yeah, yep.
So I'm assuming there's a ton of race fans out there and a ton of tracks, like, maybe not, you know, for the Cup Series, but maybe ones that maybe trucks or Xfinity could visit. Let's say if, like, NASCAR, if the Cup Series has, like, an off weekend, sort of like they do with Iowa.
Well, to be totally honest with you, like, kind of where I'm from is pretty remote. Mm. We've got, I think, only like two tracks in Idaho, one being close to me, one about an hour and a half, and then the other one recently shut down in northern Idaho, but that's 13 hours away. Mm. So not really, honestly. It's kind of we're kind of in a weird little spot where people always had laughed at me when they asked me what my first like NASCAR race that I went to was, and it was in 2014 at Iowa. But that's because my only other options were Las Vegas, which is 9 hours from me, Phoenix, which is 12, or I get down into California, which is 13, 14, 15. Those are the only options I had. So it just wasn't realistic for us to get to a race anytime soon. But, I think it would be cool to see, you know, trucks or Xfinity get back to the tracks that were like, remember, like, NASCAR Northwest?
Yes.
We went to Seattle. We were going to, you know, Wenatchee in Washington and Oregon. And, you know, some of those short tracks all through there are incredible short tracks. And then there used to be, you know, Pikes Peak. There's no reason not be going to Colorado at Pikes Peak. I raced the super late model there. Incredible facility. They could totally house exactly what they need. But NASCAR has this whole safer barrier aspect, which I understand. But my rebuttal to that is, why are we taking the kids in the NASCAR K&N Pro Series and putting them on racetracks that some of them don't even have actual plumbing?
That's a good point.
But we're worried about putting the trucks, who sometimes coincide with these same speeds as these K&N cars, and we're requiring safer barriers. You know what I mean?
The Bullring doesn't have safer barriers, and that's going to be one of the first races for the ARCA Series West, right?
Right, and they're like, you know, they talk about Nashville, and I remember seeing a quote that was like, oh, Nashville's going to require $20 to $30 million in, you know, upgrades before NASCAR goes there. Why? Sell it out. Don't even think about adding bleachers. Sell it out. It's an exclusive event. It's got great bathrooms. If we can go to Eldora, and I love Eldora.
I think NASCAR's whole thing is just aesthetics. They just want the tracks to look aesthetically pleasing. They want it to look good. They want these, you know, luxury boxes. They want these, you know, these sort of things. And it's like, I'm sorry, but like most race fans, they're not, like, they don't care really to a certain extent how the track looks. As long as the racing is good, they're going to be there. They're going to sell it out no matter what. Like, Danny B took me to Nashville when I was out there for his wedding at Nashville Fairgrounds. And, like, I was just pleased just with you know, how the track looked, and like there's a ton of people out there working different events. Like there was some sort of flea market event going on out there, so that's why there was like, it was like jam-packed, I guess. Like, well, not the racetrack, but like outside the racetrack there was like a flea market like event going on there. But I got to go inside the track, and it was just like, you know, there's just a ton of history. You just get chills going in there, a lot of nostalgia. But like, I mean, these are the tracks that helped build you know, American motorsports, or I mean, just, you know, American stock car racing. So why do we have to sort of, you know, go back from our roots for some of these tracks that, okay, they look aesthetically pleasing. They have, you know, all the right luxury boxes. They have amazing seating and, you know, amazing views, but the racing's terrible for the most part.
Well, like,
I don't know.
Well, bringing up Pikes Peak, I mean, Darian, I think you can definitely attest to the fact that that was one I was bringing up. There's no one that's really has that market out there.
Oh,
right,
that's
now.
That's a very untapped market. And every time the Busch Series used to race there, it would always sell out. But they replaced Pikes Peak with, I believe, they replaced it with Martinsville in 2006. But it's still one of the oddest races ever. That was like a caution filled race, and like, yeah, the Busch Series, or at the time the now called Xfinity Series, didn't, like, they're not going to race there until they're racing there next year though, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so they're racing Halloween. There next year. So yeah, Halloween, on a Halloween, and they just visited that place once and never came back. And I forgot what other track they replaced it with, but yeah, it was odd, like, just seeing them leave because...
But, like you said, that is such an untapped market. I mean, nobody, like, everyone is sort of centered in, like, the Southeast or the Midwest or, you know, and or out West, but, like, nobody is looking at Colorado, you know? Like, well, why not?
Well, a part of the reason, too, of, like, why, you know, this ARCA series is only going to New Hampshire's and Dover's and Iowa's and that kind of stuff is the sanctioning fee. Is like NASCAR costs a ton of money to be a NASCAR sanctioned racetrack. And so, you know, this is ballpark, so I could be far off on this, but like they're going to like South Boston, or they're going to, for example, let's say they go to Meridian Speedway, you know, which is my home track. And they're like, okay, in order for the ARCA East or the ARCA West to come here, it's going to cost you just to host this race $20,000. And that's like not including purse, anything like that. Right. And it's the sanctioning fee. So a lot of these, you know, Hickory Motor Speedway, Myrtle Beach, a lot of those racetracks cannot come up with that sanctioning fee and make a return on getting fans in there. So they're forced to go take these regional touring series to your New Hampshire's, to your Dover's, to your Iowa's that are already like SMI, ISC sanctioned, because they can afford that upfront cost. And that's what is killing it. Like these short tracks can literally not afford to bring NASCAR to their tracks. They cannot afford it.
Is that fee even necessary?
It's a yes and no. I mean, like most of the tracks they go to are NASCAR sanctioned fees, but the weird thing is, and I might get a hand slap for this, but like the perks of being a NASCAR sanctioned racetrack are no longer there. Like I remember when I first started racing, we chose to race at my home track, the Wheel and All American Series, instead of tour with the super late model division that I was going to run, because the press that came with it, like, yeah. Running a NASCAR division, you were getting NASCAR, you know, hype. It was going in the NASCAR record books. Like you had that hype. But with today's like social media and the push and like everything that comes with it, you don't even necessarily like need to be NASCAR.
Oh no, you can build yourself up. That push. You can build up basically your own brand in a sense.
Right. And so that wasn't existent even like 6, 7, 8 years ago when I was racing. And so the thing that comes with like a NASCAR sanction is like the liability and the legal and the purse, and then obviously like the NBCSN like tape delay, you know, broadcast and the fan's choice. So it was like a lot of package stuff that came into it, but you can't expect that from Myrtle Beach to pay $25,000 for a 12-car K&N field.
Yeah, it's not worth it. Like it's not.
No,
worth
you're
it,
not. Right? And that's why we're going to Iowa. Yeah. And that's why we're going to New Hampshire. And it's frustrating as someone who wants to see us go to all of those short tracks and bust into those markets, like the Midwest and like, you know, down south in Texas. We should be going to like that racetrack, Houston Motorsports Park or whatever it's called now, we should be going there, but we're not because no one can afford it. And so it's just a game of money per usual.
So I guess with the Cup Series then restructuring, I guess would you say maybe a better way of going about it is instead of restructuring from the top down, go from the bottom up with the restructuring of money being passed out? Because it's like, I hear some of these series, like, you know, like even the Truck Series has problems with money from time to time now. Like, yeah, so it's just one of those deals where it seems like almost the bottom and the roots of the tree are starting to rot out while the top seems to like have this refurbished, like new leaves, everything, you know, I guess bad analogy, but you know what I mean?
Hello.
Internet's not our friend tonight.
Wow.
I would say that would be a good idea though. Probably getting that, just getting that money sort of down into those bottom series. Cause it like you said, $20,000 for a 12 car field is just not feasible. It's not feasible, realistic. It's really just not how it should be.
Yeah. It's not worth it. We're still up, right?
Yeah, we're up.
Okay, just making sure. Yeah, Hannah's just that. Dude, we're all having trouble. Well, you two are having trouble tonight. Holy crap.
Yeah, but used to be you before the season. But, yeah, I mean, that's it's just tough how it is with that right now because of the –
Yeah, she'll jump back in.
But it's just tough with how just the money is structured with it and that these lower series and all that. But I get it, though. You know, I get, like, NASCAR being under these sort of old-school deals because, I mean, when you look when this TV deal and when a lot of the stuff that NASCAR is doing with their money-wise was, like, being structured and written out, it was 2012, 2011. That was when everything was being negotiated. Like, sure, it started in 2015.
Yeah, but different times.
Early negotiations for this stuff, you know, were in 12, 13. You know, this is before basically, you know, the big... I would say it's before the latest boom of the internet with YouTube, all of that.
Her phone died. She's gonna get back on.
All right. But yeah, I mean, it's just tough, man. It's tough, and I don't have a quick fix for it. I mean, I'd say the biggest thing right now, I think that fans can do is just show support.
Just show up to the racetrack if you can. Try and help spread the word on social media. I mean, because now that you bring this up, talk about NASCAR restructuring up top. We need to be a little more concerned about the main foundation. Because, yeah, you got the Cup Series. Then you also got three other series. You got Xfinity, Trucks, and, you know, the regional Menard Series. You know, basically ARCA now. And you have to look at these and just say, okay, what's costing too much money for, you know, the little guys? And then let's figure out the top guys later. Because the top guys, they can afford to take those hits right now. The bottom guys can't. Tommy Joe Martins was on here. He basically said how much it costs for just tires alone. Like, what was it, Jared? Like, nearly, like, what, five, 10 grand?
I can't remember the numbers.
It was huge. It was a huge amount. It was an insane amount of money for one set of tires that will only be ran for about, like, I don't know, 40 to 50 laps, depending on the track. So, I mean, just imagine, you know, doing that basically for... 35, 36 weeks out of the year. I mean, it's going to take its toll, man. I mean, just the business model of racing as a whole. I don't have the solution, and neither does Jarrett. Like, we don't have any quick fixes for it.
It's small things. I think it's small steps, at least at this point, until a major plan can be.
At least acknowledge, you know, I'm glad NASCAR is acknowledging it's there. Like, hey, there's a problem. We're spending too much. We're trying to figure it out. I'm at least glad on that part that they're at least figuring that side out, rather than in recent years or in years past, just ignoring it entirely.
Yeah. I mean, well, and yeah, it's like I said, until you get a big one, just try, I guess, Band-Aids at first, but it's like, it's kind of what we were talking about a bit at the house. I know we said not to talk about stuff that happened at the house, but yeah, this one we can. It's one of those things where it's like the people running the sport right now, I think are much, you know, again, a lot of people don't see it, but I think they're in a much better position than we were in. I think they're in a lot better, you know, there's a lot better people listening to a lot more people. And I think they're starting to sort of have that balance. So, I mean, I have faith in these guys like Steve Phelps, Helton, you know, Jim France. I have faith in these guys that they would figure out a lot.
Just talking with them. I mean, you've talked with them more than me, but just talking with Phelps, he seems to know what the hell he's doing, you know?
Well, he knows what he wants to do, and he knows that there's a set plan. It's not just we're going to wait for the masses of other sports fans to really just be telling us, like, you know, what to do.
Exactly. Like they're not – I mean, obviously you listen to the fans, but – not to the point where they're basically making every single decision that you guys make. Like, no, like, do your own thing, venture out with some different things and take some risks too. I mean, just on the media aspect alone, social media, you know, the risk with Barstool Sports, AKA Storts, meme come back to life. I mean, that was impressive. And then also the whole thing with us, with, you know, bringing out the YouTubers out there, it brought so much engagement for some of these races that were either just good at best, or like the Homestead race, not necessarily the best product on track, but building up the hype and also, you know, getting the engagement during these races really keeps fans in tune to the sport as a whole. And also just like, you know, throughout the week as well, when there's nothing going on, and also during the off season, which is most important.
Yeah. And I guess, you know, I think we can sort of move on from the subject now, I guess, if you want, you know, talking about Phelps moving different stuff forward. He had said,
we love you, Phelps. Go ahead.
He had said in his presser that NASCAR hosted a fourth OEM last weekend at ISM. And I believe that, you know, from what the rumors were, it was Honda. At least that's the one that seemed like, that's the one that the name keeps popping up the most is Honda. So I guess, Honda. You know. Maybe, you know, I know another one that popped up that keeps popping up is Nissan and, you know, Hyundai and all them. But I guess where are you on that regard with the OEM? Who would it be?
Well, I would love to have more manufacturers in the sport. And if we can get like two or three at the same time, that would be epic. I don't think we've had like five or six manufacturers in the sport at the same time since really – I want to say the 70s or the 80s, back when we had like a bunch of different cars, right before it was like official, you know, like right before like some of these teams got, you know, a ton of support from these manufacturers, team wise and development wise, that sort of thing. To get Honda into the sport would be massive. It would be great because you have a lot of, I mean, there's some race fans out there who may not necessarily like the drivers, but they like the cars. And, you know, Honda and IndyCar is just killing it over there. You know, they're just killing it over there. You know, to have Honda inside NASCAR, maybe it could bring a sector of those fans coming in. And also, I think Honda does some rallycross racing, too. I think they do, like, a bunch of racing other than, you know, stock car racing. So that would be cool to have them in. And also to have Nissan in, too. Like, new players in the game, too, to sort of help step up. You know, the current manufacturer's game inside the sport would be epic, because right now it's just dominated by one, Toyota, and they only have like five, like basically.
Well, there's always going to be a dominant. There's always going to be a dominant one. You know, like for a while, you know, it's been Toyota, but before that it was Chevrolet. Before that there was Ford and Chevy, and you know, it just there's always going to be that dominant manufacturer. But I guess adding more might elevate the competition. I guess
it's gonna elevate if there's like five.
You need more wiggle room. That's the thing. I think you need more wiggle room with rules, with what you can innovate. I think the more and more that you restrict stuff, the closer and closer you get. And I think we've seen with this Gen 6 is these cars are basically clones, but same deal. The racing under this has been worse than the last one. Right, the COT was, in my opinion, not as good as the Gen 4. You know, and it I think it just goes with that. That sort of trend. I see that. Thanks, DRA, for the $5. It says I'd love to see Acura come to NASCAR. Sorry, my phone's been wonking out. I know it's Honda technically, but I always had a soft spot for them. So yeah, I mean, really, honestly, for the most part, as long as they're willing to play by the rules, and also if there's less rules. That would be better. As long as they're willing to play by the rules and work their way up, you know what? I'm open to most. I know a lot of people keep dropping Dodge in there.
They're not coming back.
Not for a long time.
Yeah.
You know,
coming back for a while.
As tough as that is. Hold on one second. Yeah. I mean, I would want that. Truthfully, I would want that. I want Dodge back in. But just realistically at this point, I think fans are getting their hopes up for something to be disappointed by with that one. I think it's probably going to be Honda or Hyundai or you know, who else did I put in there? You know, just it's those, or Nissan, I should say. You know, those ones you keep hearing about are probably the ones who are interested. You know, the ones that you don't hear anything about, but fans say, oh, I want them. You know, maybe in a once in a blue moon that might happen, but I don't think in this regard it's going to. I think it's the ones you keep hearing about, so I think it's going to be probably Honda. I think people got to brace for impact for the people that really aren't crazy about that. I mean, I know that they've been dominant in IndyCar, but haven't they kind of like bought out a lot, you know, just sort of thrown the money at it for the most part? Oh, yeah.
No, they've thrown everything, but
here's the thing. As much as I love money being put into the sport and helping them out, which is great, there comes that double-edged sword that if they, you know, unless they put a spending cap, which then can be worked around, unless it's like one, like an incredibly strict one that everything has to go through NASCAR, they're probably, under the system we have now, going to outspend probably even Toyota. And then you're going to have another dominant one. And I think you run into the same problems. So I guess, you know, my deal is I think NASCAR needs to, with this, you know, because they were saying that to attract more manufacturers, they need to take the horsepower down. And that's just the you know, what do you call it?
Damn, I don't know. What do you call it?
Yeah, you know what I mean.
I know what you're talking about.
But it's just, it's tough because they might not even, you know, I would think if they're changing this, it's because the person is, or the manufacturer is going to come in.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think they're going to openly say this stuff out there if the manufacturer isn't interested, like obviously interested, but, you know, incredibly interested and is more than likely going to be jumping on. Mm-hmm. I guess it's just one of those deals where it's like the more manufacturers get in, there are going to be the more people who are going to have a voice at the table. More people are going to be saying stuff. Then there's going to, you know, and there's going to be constant wars about, well, why aren't we doing good? And maybe it's because your driver's good. No, you know, it can't be because our drivers aren't good. It's because you guys are favoring Toyota, Chevy, Ford, Honda.
Yeah, it's always something like that.
Mercedes, yeah. I don't know, whoever wants to jump in. You know, it's one of those deals. Like, I think we're going to hear a lot more, almost, especially if more than one jumps in and we keep the current ones we have now. I think we're going to hear a lot more about manufacturer wars and about people rooting for certain manufacturers more than maybe some drivers, which I think is something that comes in other series. And even back in the day in old school, NASCAR was a thing. So I think with these kind of new school deals, I think we're going to see a lot of new or old school ideas repurposed and sort of brought back in these new kind of ways. That's sort of my long-winded take on it.
Yeah, man, you pretty much said everything. I don't have anything else to add to that, man. Yeah, we'll follow that.
And then, wow, I'm surprised we don't have too many stories left. So NASCAR, according to Adam Stern, NASCAR is interested in implementing a new shorter track package for 2020.
About time.
Yeah, yeah. Darren, you got plenty of opinions on this. Go for
dude,
it.
Dude, no dirt. Like, you have to implement a new one. Like, the response they got all season was that this package is horrible on short tracks. Please change it. NASCAR at first was like, no, we're going to keep the same thing. And after the Phoenix race, like, everyone was just livid about, you know, what's going on with this short track package. Like, yo, we can change the spoiler. Like, we can do all this stuff. Like, come on, like, do something. And NASCAR saw that, and they didn't like what they saw. So they're like, okay, fine, let's revisit the package for short tracks and see what's going on. Definitely gets a lot of driver input on it, though, because I don't know. I know NASCAR usually, like, doesn't like doing that to a certain extent because they're like, I guess they might be afraid of like drivers favoring certain things for them. But I mean, if it's going to make the racing product better, like, it's just sad we have to resort to a package for short track racing. Like, it just, I mean, short track racing is basically the bread and butter of all stock car racing. Like, you know, there's not really any sort of draft, you know, there's obviously a ton of braking. Like, it requires a ton of skill at these short tracks. And with this package at these short tracks, it doesn't help. Like, you know, you have freaking dirty air at short tracks. That's a problem. That's a huge problem. So I'm glad they were at least taking an initiative to fix it.
Yeah, this is one of those things where I think my words are all jumbled right now. When you look at what they've done with this new package, you look at the places it's improved. I'd say it's improved restarts for sure. I will not go out of my way to say it's all out improved the intermediates. But I think it's improved because they use basically the same one with a few added things at the super speedways. It's improved there. But the fact that it's hurt, basically, like I said, the bread and butter of NASCAR racing and stock car racing in general with these short tracks is something that's sad, but I think inexcusable in a way. The fact you're so focused on these tracks that you're basically, you at least have said in lip service you're trying to get away from, but you've ruined these great ones, you know, or not even, well, I would say ruined, but diminished the return on these great ones. I mean, you look at the Richmond races this year, man. I mean, it wasn't as bad as the fall one in 2014, but it was not good. I'd say Bristol was good, but I think it's been hard the last couple of years to ruin Bristol. I think this mix of new and old Bristol has really helped it in the PJ1. But then you look at Martinsville. They're talking about dirty air at Martinsville. You know what they're going through these corners? Yeah. You know, it's like it ain't fast compared to other tracks. You know, you look at New Hampshire, for the most part, before that finish, was not a great race. You look at Phoenix, it's just been going down and down and down the more they change in this direction. So I'm really, really hoping that this Gen 7 car, you know, the way they're talking about a tiered base, you know, they talk about tier-based sponsorship. They have tier-based testing, starting with these short tracks. Want to get that right, then go to the bigger tracks and so on from there.
I don't know why they've never done that before. Like, it seems like common sense. Like, okay, we're going to have different rules.
I mean, you look who was running sport before.
Yeah, like, I mean...
They were trying to save money. They're trying to save money. And I know that, like, I think spoiler changes and a few little things here and there, I guess, could probably be what you could do. Like, I don't think they'll cost that much, but I think the cost of like completely overhauling for like, I don't think individual track basis you should go for packages, but you know, it's almost like go with what you got for, you look at all those old EA games, you know, if people want to bring up EA, I'll bring up the nostalgia of EA. It's in the game. That's been going around thanks to Elijah. But you see like the career mode of it, and you see like there's short track cars, there's plate cars, there's speedway, super speed, whatever, you know what I mean. You know, there's all these different types of cars for different types of tracks, and you'll perform better. And I know it's just a game, but they at least drew that from the fact that back then they would have these specific cars, and then they wanted to go down with the COT. The goal was to go down to one strict body. Then you look, and it sort of just grows. You know, from there with the Gen 6 car, I'm hoping this new next-gen car is like sort of the step back in the direction they need to be going in. I doubt it, the way they're trying to save money, unless they're thinking of a way that they haven't announced yet, which could very well be possible. But man, it's like the fact that we got to have specialized packages, not just, you know, not like under the hood or anything, just because of aero dependency at Martinsville. Come on, guys. Thank you, Mitchell Brown, for the $2. I do miss the Twisted Sister days of NASCAR, but I do think those days are over. As much as I miss them and I want them back, I don't think they're gonna. But we can at least try and get something that's comparable to it. I think that's our biggest, you know, I think that's what all of our goal at this point is. I'd be down, like I see in the chat, to take off the splitter. I'm hoping that's where they go with Gen 7, next gen, you know. But
the more air underneath the car, the better. Well, that not too high, of course.
But. Yeah, no blowovers and flipping if we can help it.
But we just want ride height back, though. Bring it back.
I'd be down with that. You know, they've had a lot of... at least with this next-gen car, from what it sounds like, even though they're going down on horsepower, it's designed... The engines will be designed to be down on horsepower. You know, they'll be designed so that I guess there can be more throttle response. Comparatively to an engine we have now that's basically like I believe is designed to be like a 950 horsepower engine being neutered at this point to a 550 package.
It's a shame the engines won't reach their full potential on the race.
Well, and you can grow it up over time. I mean, you look and the engine packages they had beforehand. I mean, you look in the 90s and it was nowhere near the 950, I don't think, that we are at now. You know, you look at just, it grows over time. So you're going to see growth over time. It's whether NASCAR wants to change it or not mm-hmm. to keep it down, or if it's just to keep it down so these manufacturers coming in can start off on basically equal footing. I don't know. I'm not saying, you know, I don't have all the answers. I don't think it's the end of the world, though. I do think, you know, it's concerning. I'm not happy about going down on it because I think the higher you go, the better you go. Mm-hmm. But I think that they're setting it up for a direction to move the right way with it.
Hopefully so. Sport definitely needs to move in the right direction right now. That's for sure. But yeah, change up the package, adjust it to certain racetracks specifically, and hopefully that will result in better racing. We'll have to wait and see.
And then I'm not sure if you know, Hannah will be able to come back on or not, because we are heading to our last subject right now.
Yeah. If she comes on, then great. But if not, oh well.
Yeah, and it was fun having her on for sure. Yeah. I'll put out the Twitter for her in the description below. Mm-hmm. If, you know, if not. But last subject. Cole Custer has officially been confirmed to drive the 41 in 2020.
I don't know.
Go for it, man. You seem pretty excited.
I mean, damn. Like, I mean, he deserves it. 3 years in Xfinity. That's 7 wins this season. Nearly won the championship. That's 3 straight years he could have won the Xfinity championship if he got lucky. 2017, he wasn't in the Final Four, but dominated the race. So just imagine if he made it. 2018, he was about to win, but had a horrible strategy towards the end there. So it wasn't his fault. It was the crew chiefs. And then 2019, he just got beat by, Tyler Reddick. He was just better on that day, or on that night, excuse me. Cole Custer was making a few itty-bitty mistakes towards the end there. And Tyler Reddick won the championship. But Cole Custer has proved his worth in the Cup Series. And I have to give it to Stuart Haas for not rushing him early on and just letting him develop. The 41 team is in dire straits of a new driver. Daniel Suarez, whether you love him or hate him, I'm sorry, he just did not get the job done this season. And I know a lot of people will point out and say, well, it was only 1 year. Well, sometimes it can be one too many. Kurt Busch in that car, for instance, made the playoffs every single year. Like I've said before, I will say it time and time again, it is a 16 driver playoff system. It is not that hard to get into if you are, you know, have the equipment capable of doing so. You don't even have to do the best. All you got to do is just do the, you know, the basic standard and just finish it. Like, you know, have an average finish of like 20th or 17th every race, and boom, you're inside the top 15 or 16. It's that simple. And Suarez at first showed promise, was as high as 12th in the standings at first, but couldn't get it done towards the end. It was very inconsistent. And ends up losing out on the final playoff spot to Ryan Newman. No disrespect to Ryan Newman and Roush Racing, but that team was obviously in rebuild mode at the time. And Stuart Haas, that team was just coming off of a playoff appearance with Kurt Busch and even a win at Bristol the previous season. And now Roush Racing is on the rise, it seems like, again. But Stuart Haas has established itself as one of the top 3 teams in all of NASCAR, in all of the Cup Series.
I'll be fair to Suarez, though. They were down this year.
Yeah, they were down.
I mean, I know Harvick made the championship 4, but you look at comparatively to last year, those 4 cars were not as good. The 4 car, I don't think, was as good. They hit a good streak, but I don't think they were as good. Eric Almirola took a step back. Bowyer, I don't know if it's age or just the team itself, but he took a step back. Suarez and the 41 team, you know, the 41 team as a whole, if you want to look at it that way, took a few steps back. And Suarez being in there comparatively to Kurt Busch probably didn't help that. I think Daniel Suarez is a great driver, but he is no Kurt Busch. You know, you look at Ganassi, Jamie McMurray compared to Kurt Busch in that one car. No comparison. You know, Kurt Busch is just a great talent, a very underrated talent. So I will give him that benefit, I guess. But at the same time, yeah. I think a driver in that 41 car with how that team performed at certain points of the year should be in. And if Cole Custer makes it this next year and the rest of the guys don't change, I think you know straight up it's the driver.
No, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, that's a fair argument. They took a step back. Yeah, that's and it was pretty evident because I thought Almirola was gonna show out way more this year, and Clint Bowyer is just, he's running. I think it's just age at this point, and Harvick's gonna do his thing. And compared to 2018, they were never gonna have a season that topped that, because that was just, that season for them was just amazing. Like, the peak of that entire season was that Talladega race last year, when all four were just going away. But at the end of the day, even though they had an off year, they still all made the playoffs. And Suarez was left out to dry.
Oh, yeah. Personally, I do think it's Suarez. I mean, you have two top-tier rides, and the best you can do is be a 20th-place driver.
The Joe Gibbs era was understandable because he was rushed into that ride so suddenly. That's understandable. But then what doesn't help his case is that Truex takes that same team and, not necessarily the same team, just, you know, with a few modifications, and makes the final four with it. So that doesn't necessarily help his case either. But Suarez, I wouldn't consider him a bust yet. Yeah, I'd say give him a few more years.
I'll say this. If he manages somehow to get another top team, money is very possible, mm-hmm. and he's still just, you know, what's the bet with it? Then, you know, I'm sorry. That's it. You know, you can't screw up three times with three great teams. You know, it's like, you look at some drivers and they only get a 2 year shot or a 1 year shot with a great team. You'd look at, like, for instance, look at Casey Mears. He raced for Hendrick Motorsports for 2 seasons and then he was let go. It was to get Mark Martin. I don't blame Hendrick. But he wasn't real. I don't think he was given a fair shot. And you look, and he didn't run terribly in a lot of.
I mean, it's just at the time it was the wrong place at the wrong time, because you had Johnson and Gordon and Kyle Busch just like winning everything in 2007, and then 2008 you had Junior, Jimmy Johnson, and then Jeff Gordon still, you know, doing their thing, even though they were a bit off, but they still didn't make the chase at the end of the day. And are we?
Oh, probably. Since we are. I hate NIU, man. I hate this place.
Bro, this is... Thank
God. We just got a super chat, too.
Yeah.
All right, we're back. I hate NIU still. Thank you, you know... Hold on. Yep, we're back. Okay, we're back. Yeah. Thank you, Brandon, for your $5 super chat. He asks, do you think Tyler Cole could get thrown by the waysides for Hemrick's, like Hemrick Suarez later on down the road? Both showed potential in Xfinity with... both without right. They could. I don't think those ones will. And thank you, Streamville, again, for $2. I don't think they will. I think at least, probably at least one of them will not perform well. I would say probably, as much as I like Reddick, more likely Reddick, just because the equipment and the jump to Cup is going to probably be very jarring. I think the RCR equipment in Xfinity is much better compared to the field than Cup.
And also the same team, the whole team's coming up too, so they have a big adjustment to make, you know.
Yes, but I do think that these guys have a much better chance than the people that they're filling the shoes of.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, the rumors we've been hearing is Suarez might go to RCR, race full time, and
we've heard RCR, Xfinity. We've heard Petty, we've heard all of them, man. I mean,
yeah, we've heard it all.
It's really just something we got to follow into the off season for the most part.
Yeah. So. Good luck to him. I mean, I don't want to see him go. I really don't want to. I don't want to see anyone fail or whatever. Like, I mean, but at the end of the day, two top tier rides, and you haven't had one playoff appearance. I can understand if it's like, you know, the Chase era where it's only like 10 or 12, but 16 and you still can't make it in. And especially when only one win is basically required to lock yourself in, and then the rest are based on points. Come on.
I still don't think he's a bad driver, though. Like some
people, he's not a bad driver.
He's a good driver. I think he needs to go back down to Xfinity for a year or two.
Yeah, he's a very average Cup Series driver, but he's a very good Xfinity driver.
Yeah, I think he needed one more year. The Carl Edwards retirement, you know, and him being thrown back in there or up, not back in there, but up there, I think really was jarring, and I think. It kind of just set the course for the next 3-4 years.
It just set the tone. Like after that first year, like there was really no going back from that. I don't know. Just they couldn't recover. Like, I don't know who can explain it really. You know, like I mean, because
it gets harder, teams, and you can't make as many excuses when with good teams over and over again.
The teams he went to were competing for wins or championships before when he was with them. One circumstance led to another, and they didn't perform up to par. And I'm really interested. I'm really interested to see if Custer immediately starts going on a tear. Like, he doesn't even have to like win a race or anything. He just has to do the bare minimum to make
playoffs. If he's a top 10 or 12 points under the system, if you're 12th, 13th, 10th in points, you can still miss it if enough people win. I'll say this. If he's a top 10-tier driver points-wise, like if I look at my Winston Cup points that I do each week and he's a top 10-level driver, then I don't think there's any way you can deny it was Swartz. Cole Custer starts running that way, are we going to start saying immediately Cole Custer sucks? Similarly, with any of these guys, like, so for instance, if Christopher Bell, who in my opinion is probably the most talented one coming up in the past couple of years, if he doesn't run well running in that 95 car, so are we immediately going to be like a lot of people I noticed who say that DiBenedetto sucks? Is it like, are we going to say that he does? Like, I want to take more nuanced approach with how we look at it. But I mean, you look at Suarez and it's 4 years of the same mediocrity, two powerhouse teams, man. Arguably the two best in the sport over this time, it's getting hard, because I'm someone who thinks that he can succeed in the right scenario, but it's getting harder and harder to point out what that right scenario would be. And God bless it, we're off again. We can end it here. Like, once we get right back on, we'll end it up. Hey, we're back on. So, but yeah, that's all that,
Yeah, this is out of control. You keep lagging and then, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I will be back home next Wednesday night, so we won't have this problem. All right, we're back.
Thank goodness.
Yeah. I guess we can just end it there, man. We can thank them. We can thank you guys for watching, sticking through this crap. I can't fix my internet. It's the university. So unless, y'all want to, I don't know. I can't fix what the university screws up with. I'll just say that.
Yeah, he lives in the dorms, guys. It's pretty bad. Yeah. And then if I have internet problems here, I can't necessarily fix it myself either. Trust me, if we could get the best, top internet, best Wi-Fi, best, Ethernet cables we could, we would do it. Trust me, I will spend the money to make the content better. But some things are out of your control.
But like broadcasters, who something goes wrong out of their control, it's somehow my fault that the NIU internet sucks.
All right. Well, anyways, as to end on a good note, Core Season 2 is back this weekend. Friday is the Soundhead Entertainment Shootout. Saturday is the Duels. And Sunday is the Daytona 250. Core Season 2 begins. A lot of changes, too. A lot of new faces. 50% races this season, two times where. And it's basically the most basic bones to crown a champion. Consistent points that a lot of you fans love. No playoffs, no gimmicks, and no stages either. So wherever you finish in the race is basically your point total. So be on the lookout. Subscribe to the course channel. Also follow us on Twitter. We've been hyping it up a ton. Season 2 is on the way, folks. Can't wait.
And thank you guys. Just left super chats. I know that we're gonna be a bit it's gonna be a bit late because I see that we got a bit of a delay. But C. Costain says, "Hey guys, it was super cool to meet up with y'all at Homestead. What races you plan on attending next year? Any tracks that you really want to go to?" Well, I know for sure I'll be at Chicago. That's a big one. Probably a Kansas race again. Bristol for sure. I don't know, Darren. Can we talk about? You know probably better than I do which ones we can talk about, and which ones we can't.
Oh, I have yet. No clue. Yeah, I have no clue yet. Yeah, we'll have to wait in a couple weeks.
But you know that he'll be in Vegas and probably at a few of the same ones. And then Blue Jimmy 48 fan, thanks man, $10 super chat. That's awesome, man. He says, "Hope you guys had fun down at Homestead." I think we did. Been an emotional wreck after Johnson news, but it would only be fitting if I went to ISM for his last race. Let's make it happen. I'd love that, man. And dude, I understand where Michael you're coming too. From. Yeah, and Michael. I understand where you're coming from, though. Because when Junior retired, as much as I was happy for him to have the decision, it was one of those moments where as a fan you start thinking, and I know a lot of Johnson fans are going to go through this, you start thinking, was it, you know, this is my situation here, was it Dale Jr. that I liked? Or was it Dale Jr. and NASCAR? Like, did I actually like NASCAR, or was it just I like Dale Jr. kind of thing?
I was a Dale Jr. fan all the way up until 2017, and then 2018 I became a NASCAR fan, basically.
Yeah, basically that's how it was for me. But I guess that can kind of be a wrap. You know, you guys, it'll be all right. That I think Radman said in his video, that first year without him, it's going to be tough. But after that, you find a lot of different reasons you weren't looking at before that are really cool about the sport. So,
yeah.
I think that's a good place to end it. It'll be all right.
Yeah, it'll be all right.
We had a good season so far, man.
Yes, next week is the season finale on this channel. Hopefully we have
We'll be in a different place. Different internet, different results.
It'll be a lot different, yeah. And then also, thank you to Hannah Newhouse. I know she's not here. She couldn't come back on, I guess. But I'll DM her a thank you after we're done here. But it was cool to have her insight, too. And hopefully we'll have her back on for season 4.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. And I see that a lot of the fans putting stuff of, like, what tracks to go to. I'll tell you what. I'll put a post out tomorrow. And just basically asking, where do you want us to do a meetup? And we'll just see, like, where y'all are thinking, too. Because maybe we'll do one specifically that the fans have asked. We don't know. It depends on where you guys are all at. If you guys all want us to go out to Indianapolis,
yeah, man, we might do it. Anywhere. Even the most boring tracks on the schedule on the circuit, man. Let's do it. Let's just see how many fans we can get out to the racetrack. That's the challenge.
It's all for y'all. But, yeah, we got the finale next week. And then that's it for 2019. So
Season 2 is done. Holy crap. Dude, there's been so many changes.
I guess just be sure to watch. That's all we can really say. Be sure to watch. But thank you guys. I'm gonna, you know what, Darren and I will just stay quiet on that one. But thank you guys for watching, sticking through with us. Y'all that are still watching are the true MVPs of the chat. So until next time, you know what? Hold on, because it's just the end. Man, everything on my computer has problems right now. But you know what? Since it's the end, thank you guys for everything. Thank you guys for watching. And until next time, have a good one. And we're out. Green flag, green flag. I'll roll. He's pumping me.